journalism, literature and creative communication arts. He was given the award for his passionate commitment as a journalist to restore the rural poor to India's national consciousness. In a 30-year career as a journalist, Mr. Sainath has won close to 40 global and national awards for his reporting, though he has turned down several, including one of India's highest civilian awards. Mr. Sainath's book, Everybody Loves a Good Drought, has remained a non-fiction bestseller by an Indian author for years. His current work involves a series on devastation of Indian agriculture by anti-farmer policies this past decade, which runs in the Hindu, consisting of detailed reports from the household of landless laborers and marginal farmers across the country. He has published over 150 investigative reports on the agrarian crisis in the Hindu alone. Mr. Sainath has spent an average of 270 days a year in the poorest villages of India since 1993. Inspired by his work, Canadian documentary maker Joe Mullins has produced a documentary entitled A Tribe of His Own, The Journalism of P. Sainath. Till date, it has won 14 international awards, including the top ones at Columbia and Global Visions Film Festival. I now request Mr. Sainath to please deliver his lecture.
Thank you very much. We have this topic of inequality before us. Briefly, the fastest growing sector in India today and for the last 10 years or whatever is not IT, not software. The fastest growing thing in this country for the last 15 years is inequality. It is by every measurable indicator, it has grown faster in the last 15 years than at any period in the preceding 50 years of your country's independent history. Well, it's actually pretty nice to, it's quite an interesting situation towards the end of the last year when the issue of inequality and starts disturbing Mr. Ratan Tata. I found that very interesting and entertaining. Mr. Tata is very worried that what's happening in our country is going to make us a banana republic, I'm quoting verbatim, where people of lesser power go to jail and bodies are found in the trunks of cars. A very grisly thought, especially if you're a car manufacturer. like Mr. Tata is. And I suppose, you know, well, nothing pisses off a customer more than a body in the trunk, right? So, I suppose it's an even worse thought if you are the manufacturer of Jaguar Land Rover. Nice roomy trunks. Two bodies for the price of one. Right. Anyway, let's assume that, Prakash will correct me if I'm wrong, you've blocked this hall, I mean, before the audience comes for some time already. So let's assume you've taken this hall for, say, 3 hours from the evening. Two, three. Pretty good, but you know, I'm not going to revise my math for you because I've calculated it on the basis of 3 hours. You can make the adjustments. What happens in 3 hours in your country? Any 3 hours, not just the 3 hours that you and I are having a discussion over here. Any 3 hours in this country, six farmers will have committed suicide. 40 to 55 will have attempted it. 274 farmers will have quit agriculture altogether. 257 children in your country will have died of malnutrition in that time, and hundreds more will have entered grade 3 and grade 4 malnutrition. All the figures are official. They are the Government of India figures. But there's another thing that will happen in those 3 hours. In those 3 hours, when six guys commit suicide, 50 or so attempt it, 257 children die of malnutrition. In those same 3 hours, the Government of India will write off 171 crore rupees in taxes for the richest people in this country, for the corporate world, and for the high net worth individuals in your society. Do you want me to tell you how and where you can check this number? Yes. Yeah. Get onto your union budget. It's online. There's a section in the union budget called Statement of Revenue Foregone. Do you understand that? It means, okay guys, this is what we are writing off for you this time. Right? Statement of revenue foregone has 12 tables. It's one of the first annexures of the budget. Statement, one of the last chapters of the budget. Statement of revenue foregone. What it tells you is, if under a particular head of tax, you are supposed to collect so much, you're supposed to collect 100, the government says we are writing off 80. So 80% of that particular tax is written off. Let's take only three, because there are hundreds of taxes, okay? But let's just take three major taxes. One, direct corporate income tax. Any guesses on how much is written off in the current budget? 80,000 crores. That's for a handful of people. That's for a handful of people, okay? It's not for a giant body of human beings. 80,000 crores is the direct corporate income tax write-off. Second, the customs write-off is in the region of 149,000 crores, and the excise duty write-off, all these are mainly availed off by the better-off sections of society. You want to break that up, I can do it for you. 279,000 crores is the excise duty write-off, the customs duty, or rather the other way around, customs duty write-off is 279,000 crores, and 149,000 crores is the excise write-off. You know how much that adds up to? 500,000 crores. 492 or 494,000 crores, these three heads. You know how much that works out to? It works out to 57 crores per hour, or 1 crore per minute approximately. The same government does not have money for a universal public distribution system. It does not have money to go from 25 kgs to 35 kgs per family for food entitlements. Tamil Nadu is a very exceptional state, as are two or three other states. But for all those programs, there's no money. As you know, the Prime Minister himself turned down an NAC request for increasing entitlements under the PDS. In fact, he turned down a letter which came from his boss. Right? So they don't have money for that, but 80,000 crores. Now, incidentally, the budget itself makes the observation very clearly that this is a very disturbing trend. It says it needs to be reversed, and the table then shows you that it has actually increased every year. You can't write off more than 80%. They have. It's 80% of the write-off. My friends, these are not the subsidies. You want to get into the subsidies, then we need all night. Okay? We're just talking about write-offs under three heads. This does not include land and water subsidies. It does not include physically acquired land from poor farmers, which is then handed out at throwaway rates to the super rich of this country. This does not include the SEZ subsidies. It does not include water and electricity subsidies given to large corporations. It does not, for instance, include the subsidies given to the IPL. Are you aware that there are substantial public subsidies to the IPL, whose team owners include four people on the Forbes billionaires list? Are you aware of this? Who are those four billionaires who are Forbes billionaires who are the IPL owners? Yes. Vijay Mallya, Mukesh Ambani, GMR Rao, and KP Singh, DLF. He's the title sponsor. These four guys own IPL teams for which you are paying. Okay, who is the sponsor of Mukesh Ambani's Mumbai Indians? New India Assurance, public sector company. Why the heck should the public sector be paying for Mukesh Ambani's investments in cricket? Right. They got tax write-offs from the government of Maharashtra for educational purposes. You know? Yeah, because cheerleaders were a new element in Indian education. So, we never had that in our education. So let's be fair. So these are the write-offs under just three heads: in direct corporate income tax, excise duty, and customs duty. 57 crores a minute. So in our 3 hours, we are talking about a write-off of 171 crores in the 3 hours that you have the hall, or Prakash would probably make it 150 crores because he took it only for 2.5 hours. Yeah. By the way, that 500,000 crores write-off in the union budget, the 80,000 crores in direct income tax write-off last year was 68,000 crores. So you can see the percentage rate at which it's grown. They've very helpfully given you a table so that you don't have to trouble yourself too much. Tables 5 to 12, that's the list of tables that you need to look at in the statement for revenue foregone. 500,000 crores write-off is 2.5 times your 2G scam. Except that this scam is written into your budget. So it's 2.5 times your scam, 2G scam, or if you are couple Sybil, it's 500,000 times, crore times bigger than the scam, because there were no losses in the 2G scam. But anyway, I guess things are looking up. If you notice, it's been 100 hours, 4 days have passed without a single new scam of over 100,000 crores popping up. So I guess things are looking up. Incidentally, what does the government plan for? Then you also have another form of looting of the Indian exchequer. How many of you have looked at the global financial integrity report on illicit fund transfers? Many newspapers have not covered it. They've chosen not to cover it. They have mentioned it. The Hindu and Business Line did cover it extensively. I wrote the story in the Hindu. You're losing 240 crores a day in money taken out by the same guys who get all these subsidies, by the same guys who get these write-offs. Global Financial Integrity is a Washington think tank that is not, by any stretch of imagination, a radical outfit. They are good, strong advocates of the market, etc., etc., but they are worried about the illicit finances leaving countries and going into Swiss banks. Their calculations do not include smuggling, narcotics, and all those other pleasant side activities that we have. Okay, they just are talking about rich people and companies taking money, evading tax, and parking it in Swiss banks and Cayman Islands and Bermuda and Man of Isle and Liechtenstein and Luxembourg and a couple of other places that no one can pronounce. You know how much money has left India in this form? According to Global Financial Integrity, $462 billion. Actually, on the way here, as Prakash will tell you, that's what I was calculating on the calculator to figure out how many bloody zeros that is that in rupees. It is actually the $462 billion that have been looted by your country's super rich is equal to 21 lakh crores. 21, that's 10 or 12 times the size of your 2G scam, right? 10 to 12 times the size. Okay, but even more interesting, this is independent India's history of scamming in the illicit funds. But how much of this money has gone out in the period of liberalization? Half, more than half has gone out in the last 20 years. How much of it has gone out in the last 8 years from 2000 to 2008? Because the report stops at 2008. In those 8 years, $125 billion, which is 5,60,000 crores, three times the size of your 2G scam, has gone out by the very people to whom you are also giving those concessions in the statement of revenue foregone. The Global Financial Integrity Report says absolutely categorically, they use cute language for who's responsible, they call it the drivers of illicit flows, which means the bandits. It's a polite term saying the drivers of illicit flows. And it says very categorically, one, corporations, two, high net worth individuals. These are the two categories, it says, who take the money out and park it abroad. Now, what is the government of India planning to do for this? Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, who has announced the 96th group of ministers. There are actually now far more groups of ministers than there are ministers. Okay? Do we have one to study the APL entitlements? Another group is studying how to raise the price of APL food grain. A third group is studying how to raise the prices of diesel. A fourth group is studying how to mitigate the effect of the rise of food grain prices. You know, and the guy in charge of the food grain is your minister, who in Vidarbha, where I've come from, is not called the Krishi Mantri, he's called the Cricket Mantri. Let's be fair on him. I mean, APL, BPL, IPL, what's the difference, right? if you look at this, these are the write-offs for each of these guys. By the way, many of the companies benefiting from the write-offs and many of the individuals whose names are now showing up in those accounts are the same guys who have shown up in the LIC loans for bribe scam, DB Realty, the same bunch of people, because the actual number of companies and people involved, rich people, is actually quite small. It's a very compact group. So you have this tremendous, absolutely incredible looting going on. at the rate of 240 crores a day, it's much more, that's the average for 50 years. It's much more intense in the last 8 years, right? And the same, and in terms of write-offs from non-repayment of loans, on average over the last 20 years, it's been between 40 to 50,000 crores. When a rich man owes money and doesn't pay it, you don't call it a bad debt. You call it a non-performing asset. It's an asset. It's a non-performing asset. Today it isn't working for you. Someday it will, when it takes the economy down totally. The last month or so, I've spent a lot of time in Marathwada, which is a part of Maharashtra, and Vidarbha, also a region in Maharashtra. Marathwada is where all the chief ministers of Maharashtra generally come from, except with the exception of Mr. Pawar when he was CM. But a lot of them come from Marathwada. Now, here you have all these giant write-offs for all these big guys so that they can take their money and park it in Switzerland or whichever other place they're going to. I'm sure most of you in this room have either seen on television or read in your newspaper that in October, Mercedes-Benz made its single biggest sale ever in this country when a group of businessmen in Aurangabad, best known for Ajanta, Ellora and not for Mercedes-Benz, and with a per capita income, annual per capita income of around 30,000 rupees, Aurangabad's businessmen bought 150 Mercedes-Benz at one shot. You saw that? You read about it? You heard about it?
Yes.
So none of you is unfamiliar with that. But how many of you know where the money came from? The deal was worth 63 crores. Who paid for it? The loan, 44 crores loan, came from the public sector, State Bank of India, at what rate of interest? 7%. What are your housing loans now? Okay, what is the farmer's loan? 7% interest, and the same 7% interest deal is now being worked out for another group of businessmen in Kolhapur who are trying to outdo these guys. They've reached 100 BMWs so far. But both loans are coming from the State Bank of India, a public sector. I am absolutely confident that many of these businessmen are never going to repay that loan. They are politically powerful. It will be written off as a non-performing asset. Though the Benz performs very well for them, but they're not going to pay. The same State Bank of India that charges you 7% interest on the Mercedes-Benz, on a loan for buy a Mercedes-Benz, charges a farmer 12.75% for a tractor loan that is much less than the Mercedes-Benz. 12.75% on a tractor loan is what you will pay if you take 4 lakhs. If you take 5 lakhs, it goes up to 13.2%. You go up to 6 lakhs, it's 14%. So you're paying 7% if you buy a non-productive Mercedes-Benz, and which you're going to default on for sure. And you pay up to 14% to buy a tractor. Welcome to India 2011. That is the state of your inequality and thing. One of the things that, after this, in the same Marathwada, I visited the house of, we'll come back to Marathwada in a bit. In the neighboring region of Vidarbha, I visited the house of Hargobind Harane, a paddy grower. It's very, very rare that paddy growers commit suicide. Very rare, because overwhelmingly the farmers' suicides in your country are those of cash crop farmers, because their risks are much higher. One of the biggest policy decisions. The inequality in your country is different from earlier inequality. You know, one could say, well, there was always inequality in India, right? Right, sure. The difference between the inequality of the last 20 years and the inequality of the preceding 45 years is that never has inequality been so cynically constructed, so ruthlessly engineered by design with theories of trickle-down and other ideological justifications. It is the inequality in your society today is policy-driven, as you can see in the tractor versus Mercedes-Benz, in the tractor versus Mercedes-Benz example. It is policy-driven. It's a decision somebody has taken and imposed on society. Anyway, I went to the house of Hargobind Harane, who was refused bank loans and was selling his paddy crop, which has an MSP, a minimum support price of 1,000, he was selling it to the trader for 825 rupees. That is, he was losing 175 rupees on every quintal of paddy that he was selling. Though there's a Government of India procurement order for 1,000. Why didn't he sell? Government of India announces the procurement rate and then does not procure. It says the godowns are full. Why are the godowns full when people are hungry? Good question. But you know that debate. I won't go into it now. However, Hargobind Harane was finally so broke that when he decided to commit suicide, he went to the kade, the Krishi Kendra, bought pesticide on credit and swallowed that. Educated farmer, M.A. Marathi. Marathi is the most difficult M.A. in Maharashtra. It's like M.A. Tamil is a very difficult M.A. to do. It's a high quality degree in Tamil Nadu. M.A. Marathi, wife is a 10th standard pass. Very highly educated for a farm girl. Right? No loans for Hargobind Harane. He wasn't, unfortunately, he didn't have the brains to buy a Mercedes-Benz. Right? So that's what, he just took his pesticide and died. Three districts down in Amravati, I went to the house of Marutrao Doke, whose wife committed suicide. She was the head of the household. She was the working farm household head. Incidentally, to those of you who don't know it, 19% of all rural households are women-headed in this country. But when they commit suicide, we don't count it as a farmer's suicide. Because woman, how can a woman be a farmer? A woman is a farmer's wife. Because in your country, women don't have properly recognized property rights. Their names are not on the patta. I've had this argument with 1,000 tehsildars. Why have you not included her as a farm suicide? She's not a farmer, sir. Show me the patta. Where is her name on the patta? She's not. So thousands of farm suicides of women don't get counted because they're not counted as farmers. They're counted as suicides, but not as farmers' suicides. Got it? So Marutrao Doke's wife, he is infirm, he's had tuberculosis. She ran the farm, she committed suicide. The last thing which she did before committing suicide was to try raising money for the second attempt at the crop after the excess rains, which you know destroyed a lot of crop. So she pawned her Mangal Sutra. The proceeds of the pawning of the Mangal Sutra also paid for her funeral rites. After that, the whole village, the neighbors, everybody put money together and got the Mangal Sutra back from the moneylender. The money from the Mangal Sutra pawning paid for her 13th day ritual observance of her death. These people can't get loans. Now, when I'm saying they can't get loans, there's an obvious contradiction, isn't it? The contradiction is that Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, before him Mr. Chidambaram, and before Mr. Chidambaram, Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, all of them have told you that we have doubled rural credit, we have tripled rural credit. Oh yes, they have. They only give you absolute numbers. On an economy growing 9%, the doubling of the rural credit is actually a negative growth. You see, if I am giving out 10 rupees and I give out 20 rupees, it is not a huge increase in the rural credit, but more, what is it in percentage? Do you know what is rural India's share of total loans and advances of all scheduled commercial banks in this country? What is the percentage of people in rural India according to the census? 72%. What is the percentage of all loans and advances to rural India? And that includes the rural rich, okay? It's not as if, that's not to poor people, that's to rural India. What would you take a shot at guessing the percentage? 7.93%. Where do you get the data from? The quarterly journal of the RBI, the Reserve Bank of India. Right, 7.93%. Most of which again is cornered. So what we did is, Professor R. Ramakumar of the Tata Institute of Social Sciences looked at where the agricultural credit goes. Now we're not talking about rural credit, we're talking about agricultural credit. Who gets the agricultural credit? We found that it goes to poor, struggling farmers like Mukesh Ambani. Well, you see, Bombay has a different kind of farming. It's not contract farming, it's farming off contracts. Right. But what did we find? We took the data for, Professor Ramakumar took the data for India, 2000 to 2008, and Professor Pallavi Chavan, who's actually working with the Reserve Bank of India, took the data for Maharashtra to find out where agricultural credit goes. The first thing will tell you where it goes. 2000 to 2008, you look at it, when you look at agricultural credit, you look at the size of the loan. From the size of the loan, you get an indicator of who's taking it. Okay, now Mr. Ambani is very unlikely to take a loan of less than 25,000 rupees. I hope you'll agree. What are the loans that increased and what are the loans that decreased in those 6 to 8 years from 2000? Loans below 25,000. Who takes loans below 25,000? Small and marginal farmers. Because you take, suppose you're a cotton farmer in Vidarbha today, you get 5,000 rupees per acre as your crop loan. So small and marginal farmers take loans of under 25,000 rupees. The number of loans of less than 25,000 rupees collapsed to less than half what they were in 2000. So that means small farmers are getting fewer and, am I confusing you? Do you understand that small farmers are then getting fewer and fewer and fewer loans because the number of loans of less than 25,000 rupees has collapsed? Anyone wanting to guess which size of loans shot up and doubled? Shot up massively, maybe in some cases more than double, but shot up. Loans of over 10 crores and loans of over 25 crores went up massively. I don't know which of you have last met a poor and marginal peasant taking a loan of 25 crores, but I can't seem to remember one in 17 years of working full-time in the countryside. So even within the money that goes for agricultural credit, it's been siphoned toward, why? Because around in the mid-90s, a huge policy shift was made when we redefined priority sector lending and brought in institutional players. Today, rural credit goes to ICICI, goes to Reliance, goes to Monsanto, goes to Cargill through their front companies, goes to Monsanto through Mexico. So giant institutional players are getting what was designed originally for small and marginal farmers, which is what made the Green Revolution, etc., etc., etc. So you have loans of over 10 crores and 25 crores increasing. So it means that even that pathetic share for the farmer is being eaten by the big guys. That is really what has happened. Let me tell you what the law is now. What is the law, what is the reworded law, or it's in the Union Budget. Please read the speech of Mr. Pranab Mukherjee. It shows you that if today, if say Vijay Mallya opens a cold storage in Bengaluru in MG Road, he gets agricultural credit at 6% to 7%. He gets agricultural credit. Why does he get agricultural credit? Cold storage, man. You keep vegetables in cold storage. The guy who grows the vegetables commits suicide. He doesn't get loans. But Vijay Mallya will get it if he opens that cold storage in Bengaluru, because that's connected to agriculture. The budget of 2010, if you read the finance minister's speech, it says categorically, excise and customs exemptions for air-conditioned and refrigerated vehicles, which is what is used for transportation of produce by super retail size people, okay? Not by small farmers. They don't have AC bullock carts yet. Right? So this is where your agricultural credit money is going. But we'll come back to that too in a bit. What you're looking at is the most incredible inequality of our times that this country has ever known as an independent nation. After 20 years, and it's policy driven, because if you look at 1991 or look at even 1999, 2000, there is no dollar billionaire in your country. Today, you are fourth or fifth in the list of nations in dollar billionaires. By the way, my favorite website permanently bookmarked is ForbesBillionaires.com. That's a page, you know, I keep watching it thinking one day. Right. So ForbesBillionaires.com is a page in Forbes.com. Right, you can see the stupendous march of India shining through each year. Incidentally, there was a sudden depopulation of billionaires. We lost half of them, alas, in the 2008 meltdown. But because of your stimulus packages worth 10 lakh crores, they are back and they've increased the number that they had in 2008 by a couple. Okay, now you have 53 of them. You are fifth in the world now, because China has suddenly muscled in. They always spoil our party, right? So, but who are the first? First is, of course, the obnoxious number of billionaires in the United States. Second is Russia and Germany, and then us. I'm not going to take note of China. We're not, you know, we're not bothered about China. We're competing with the West. Though we are fourth in the number of billionaires, we are actually second in the net asset worth of our billionaires. Meaning our billionaires are worth a hell of a lot more. Our 53 billionaires are worth a hell of a lot more than Russia's 84 billionaires. And then you see there is the obvious moral superiority we have over the Russians. Their billionaires go to prison after 10 years. After 10 years, we send our billionaires to parliament. let's leave aside all these petty would-bes and wannabes and concentrate on the main chance, which is the United States. Now here is something. Every year that our number of billionaires, dollar billionaires rose, every year that our number of dollar billionaires rose, our ranking in human development fell. The last human development report of the old index, what was called the Human Development Index, was 2009. In a year when we ranked fourth in the number of billionaires in the world, we ranked 134 in human development out of 177 nations. Do you know who all are ahead of you in the Human Development Index? Every single Latin American country there is ahead of India, including Bolivia, which many see as the poorest of Latin American nations. Quite a few African nations, my friend, are ahead of you. Okay? Botswana is ahead of you in human development. By the way, all your neighbors are mostly ahead of you, except on one or two indicators. Sri Lanka is 20 positions ahead of you. Vietnam, 30 positions ahead of you. Cuba, 80 positions ahead of you. Not a neighbor, but just to give you an idea of how others have done. Now, these 133 nations that are above you include 100.